Don't Give Up, Peter Gabriel, from his album So, released in 1986, featuring the amazing bass work of Tony Levin. And those of you who may not be familiar with Tony Levin, well, he's played with just about everybody. He's been a session musician since the early 1970s. He's played with and toured with some of the greatest musical acts of all time. In addition to that, he's a regular member of the band King Crimson. he's been Peter Gabriel's bass player for a long, long time now. And when you have a situation where the music itself lends itself to experimentation, you know, trying different ideas, different sounds, and then you have a guy like Tony who is already in that mindset, playing all kinds of different bass type instruments. You know, Tony was one of the first guys to play a five string with a low B. He was a fretless player as well. He's famously known for playing the Chapman stick, which is basically just a fingerboard that you tap on to get the notes out. He's done so many different things like that. He's played with drumsticks taped to his two fingers and played the bass that way. Sounds pretty cool. Well, in this tune, he's actually playing chords. And he makes a pretty convincing argument for the idea of bass players learning how to play chords on the bass. Now, these aren't chords in a strict sense. They're what we call double stops. They're two notes played at the same time. Technically, a chord is three notes at least. But, you know, double stops can still absolutely give you the sound of a chord. So we'll take a look at what he's doing. Well, the song is in C minor, and the instrumentation is totally sparse. You know, it's really a showcase for Tony's bass. There's some keyboards and piano on it. There's some percussion, but it's very minimal. And after that, it's just the vocals of Peter Gabriel, and then in the chorus, Kate Bush. So, here we go. We said C minor, right? Okay, and we're talking about C natural minor. Three flats. Here's the notes on the scale. C, D, E flat, F, G, A flat, B flat, C. No Dorian or any mode thing like that, just minor. And the first thing he's got is root fifth. C, G, G. C and E flat is our first double stop. Right? To D and B flat. Which really makes it sound like a B flat chord. So. But the thing of it is, there's no B flat chord going on the keyboards or anything. There's also no low B flat bass note. So it's really airy sounding. It's open. Back. And you see, the thing of it is, one reason why this part works so well is that it's like a complete statement right there. You know, even though you have this open-ended sort of arrangement, but it's a melody. Right there. Just that much, that's a complete song. It's a short song, but you see what I'm saying? It's a whole melodic idea that started and finished. And that's the thing. I mean, it's very recognizable to the ear that way, even though it's a bass, right? So, does that a few times. Now, what does he do? He moves up to the relative major. We're in C minor, right? Moves up to an E flat. E flat major. And we're going to do this. Root fifth again, which is E flat, B flat. okay, it's like an E flat major chord. We got E flat and G together, the root and the third. Now this one. Now, that took me a long time to hear correctly. I used to think it was this, which sounds great, too. But there was always something there that was rubbing. Let me show you what I thought it was. E flat and G going to D and F. All right? It's actually not a D, it's an E flat. So you get like an E flat sus 2. Wow. Now, see, now on the repeat of that little phrase, he does do the F and D. And I don't think he does it that way live. I think this was just a thing he did in the studio. I think the live version, and maybe that's why I always thought it was this. I think he does play it that way sometimes. He might change it around a bit. I'm not sure. But on the studio recording, that's how I did it. Now down to B flat, which is the 5 of E flat, right? Root 5th again, B flat and F. See, he does go to a B flat chord, B flat and D, but he got there from a step above C and E flat. Check that out. So on the repeat of that phrase, B flat D, B flat E flat, a 4th. That's pretty cool. And then back to the C minor. So it's almost like it's a 4 measure phrase all together. We have the C minor. That's 1. E flat. B flat. C minor. And that's it. All right. And if you really listen to the recording, he puts in very slight variations at times, mostly just rhythmically, you know. But overall, that's a summary of the main theme. All right. Another thing I should mention: this song is in 6/4 time. I guess you could think of it as 3/4 or 6/8 as well. Doesn't matter. It's all the same triplet type feel. The only reason that would matter is how you would notate it. You know, that when you have those kinds of time signatures, 3/4, 6/4, 6/8 can all basically be used for the same thing. I'm thinking 6/4, just for me, easier way to count it. We get to the chorus. Now, he's just playing root notes here, right? We're still in the key of E flat. These are all diatonic chords, which we're going to talk about in a second. But we've got F minor for measure, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. E flat over G for a measure, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. A flat, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 for 2 measures, right? Now, how do I know that those chords are what they are just from a single bass note? Well, apart from the fact that I also know the keyboard part, I mean, you can do this. Okay, so, all right, what did I do there? I'm playing what's called a 10th on the bass, an interval of a 10th. So if I'm playing a low F, an octave is right there, right? 8 notes, 9, 10. And what a 10th essentially is the same thing as the root and the third of the chord. The third is just placed an octave higher. And it's on a bass, it's much clearer that way. You know, I mean, first of all, there's no way in this key to play a low A flat and an F together. But if I played it like this, right, it's kind of like squished together. That's much clearer sounding, right? So that clearly spells out an F minor. Okay. Why do I think that that's E flat over G as opposed to G minor? That's a good question. Now, when you do chords like this, you know, you can experiment by doing a full triad like this. Now, what did I do there? G, B flat, D, right? That's literally a G minor triad, just straight up. But if I go like this, right, I move the D note up a half step to E flat. So now I have E flat, B flat, G. That's an E flat chord in first inversion, also known as E flat over G. So if I played this part in chords, you see that now it sounds better. And by the way, that F minor really is more like F minor 7, right? That's really the, you see? Now, I can go into a whole rabbit hole here of a voice leading and a whole thing about that, but maybe we'll save that for another time. What I do want to show you, though, is this idea. So, you know, we've been talking about, like, these double stops, right, for the main theme. And then I showed you how you could use double stops here during the chorus to discern, you know, the chords. Well, it's a cool thing on the bass for two reasons. One is, and you do this on a guitar too, by the way. This is a lot of fun on a six-string guitar. To use the bottom string and the top string, just playing two notes together as double stops to really learn your fingerboard and to really learn a key and make up little tunes and things, right? I said we were in C minor, right? All right, so I'm gonna just play root and third for all of these chords. There's a C and an E flat. I could use two fingers if I want, you know. A D and an F, an E flat and a G. I can keep going up. F, A flat, G, B flat, A flat C, B flat D, and I think I can get it. Yeah. C and E flat, right? And chords naturally will sound a little clearer higher up, but you don't have to do it that way. I'll start on the C again. Now, and, you know, I tell you the truth, this concept, I actually got this idea from a guitarist named Mike Stern. Mike Stern is a very well-known jazz fusion guitar player. And I used to go see him play live all the time at a place called the 55 Bar in New York City. And it was a little dive bar, and, the band would be playing 3 feet in front of you, you know, where, while you were sitting at the bar there. But Mike always would do the same kind of set list, and usually the third tune in the set was a ballad. And he'd always start the ballad with an unaccompanied guitar solo, you know, just free time kind of thing, just playing all these beautiful chords and runs and all kinds of things. And I remember quite a few times hearing him do this kind of thing, like and just double stops like that on the guitar, and they were just basically diatonic chords in whatever the key was of the tune. But I found that to be such a cool idea. And I never heard anyone else do that before. And so I remembered it, and I started trying to play it on the bass as well. And I think it works great. And you know, the thing of it is, you can also imply diminished chords when you do it. Check this out. So if I go, let's say, I'm implying F minor, G minor, or E flat over G, like I said before. A flat, A diminished. All I had to do was move an A flat and a C to an A and a C. B flat, B diminished to C minor. Now you have to know where those things are, but in any of the 12 keys, that move from, like, if we're in E flat major, the 4 chord, up a half step, to the 5 chord, up a half step, to the relative minor. That'll always work, you know. So those are some cool things. But anyway, getting back to Don't Give Up. So you see that. Fun with those things. You can find a lot of music on the bass using that type of concept. Last thing with Don't Give Up, the very coda of the tune, Tony goes ahead and plays this sort of. So it's just a vamp out in C minor, C to E flat, C to F, E flat, F, C, G, B flat, C. And then he plays a low E flat on the 5 string. I'm almost certain he played a 5 string Ernie Ball Music Man on the recording of this tune. In fact, I remember an interview with him, and he's talking about it, and that muted sound that he gets, he actually stuffed a diaper under the strings near the bridge to get that dampening kind of sound. When I recorded it for my version, I just put a piece of foam there. I got pretty much the same effect. So, yep. And that's actually a low E flat, an octave lower. So, all right. Well, I hope you enjoyed today's breakdown. And if you did, please consider subscribing to my channel. And there'll be more videos like this to come. Thanks for watching.